morning. You may be seated. Welcome to the 2017 commencement exercises for Beulah Heights University. In 1 year, Beulah Heights University will be celebrating its 100th year anniversary as we become part of a unique club of institutions with a centennial's worth of history and legacy. As we march towards that celebration, we will highlight the biblical principles that we were founded on, the boldness that we will progress, that will progress us into another century of academic excellence, and the boundless potential that we will build upon. For over 99 years, Beulah Heights University has been impacted by and has been impacting nations from all across the world. It is our custom that we begin our commencement exercises by recognizing the diversity of the different flags from the nations that are represented by our current student body. Today, we have 20 nations represented, and we're going to celebrate them with our procession of flags. Let us begin by celebrating the United States of America. Angola. Australia. The Bahamas. Bermuda. Brazil. British Virgin Islands. Democratic Republic of Congo. Ghana. Guatemala. Guyana. Haiti. India. Jamaica. Kenya. Liberia. Mexico. Nigeria. South Africa. And South Korea. We are truly grateful to God for his blessings of diversity and the unity that we experience every day at Beulah Heights University. I ask now that you would please stand as we receive the presentation of the colors from the Lithonia High School JROTC, followed by the United States National Anthem performed by saxophonist Richard Shaw.
Let's bow for prayer, please. Father, it is in you that we live and move and have our being. And apart from you, we recognize that we can do nothing. Today is a day of thanksgiving. Today is a day of celebration. Thank you so much for who you are, and thank you for this graduating class today. Father, we give you praise and honor for Beulah Heights University. We thank you for a school that honors you and that's raising up people for the ministry as well as the marketplace. Now we thank you that you carefully orchestrated and uniquely gifted each and every graduate. I pray that they walk fully in the purpose for which you have ordained that they walk. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would begin to so orchestrate their lives that maximum glory will be given to your name because of the good works that you're going to do through them. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Now we invite you into our time today. We invite your presence. We thank you for being in this place. Breathe upon this service. Breathe upon this people. Let your presence be obvious, God. And for that, we give you thanks. We give you glory. We give you honor in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. While you're standing, let's go ahead and give God a big praise and a shout. Hallelujah. We're going to turn this into a Beulah Heights chapel today, where we're going to have a little church. Come on, I'm chasing
after you, no matter what I have to do.
I need you. It's okay to clap. More and more. praising my way through just to be closer to you. I'm chasing after you.
I'm chasing after you.
I'm praising my way.
More and more.
like to a big old choir rehearsal. Unto the Lord.
It's our commencement day. But before we give any more praise to anyone, let's give the best shout to our Lord Jesus Christ. Yay! Yay! You may be seated. You may be seated. Thank you so kindly. Thank you. Because I know many of you are going to receive the shout. But I need to start from our Lord and Savior. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, worship team. Thank you. Thank you so much for the work that you do. I just want to say welcome to the 2017 commencement for Beulah Heights University and to congratulate all the students and the faculty for the great work that they have done. To our board of trustees, to our faculty, family, and friends, I want to say welcome and thank you so much. We can't do anything without you. I want to say thank you also to the pastors who have sent all these students to come and study, all the fathers, mothers, wives, husbands, who have sacrificed your time to send these students to be with us. I want to welcome President from Bahamas, who is with us here today. Willis, thank you so much. We have an extension in Bahamas. Welcome. And also, I want to do something different from what we normally do every year. Every year, I start with a speech and small speech to welcome you and to congratulate you. But I want to do something different. Because the founder of this ministry, Bishop Eddie Long, for the many years, over 30 years, he has served in Beulah Heights in one different or the other. He was a board member. He was the chair of the board. He was the largest donor, and many other things that he did. But early this year, he passed and went to be with the Lord. And in his place, he came another angel, Bishop Stephen Davis, who is with us here today. I met him a few years ago when we had lunch, about five, six of us, in a secluded area. I'm not going to say where. But I never knew at that time, you did not know this journey that you'll be here and trying to fill out the shoes of this ministry. We welcome you, we pray with you, and thank you for affirming that the relationship that Bishop Long started with the Beulah Heights University will continue. And I just want to give him just a few moments to welcome us officially here at New Birth, Bishop Davis.
Thank you, Dr. Kianja. To Beulah Heights University, I welcome you today on behalf of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church and on behalf of the late Bishop Eddie L. Long. Thank you so much for choosing this place as a venue in order to celebrate those who are moving forward in life. And we do extend our relationship, and we will continue to support, and we will walk out the legacy of Bishop Long, and those relationships that were dear to him are also dear to myself and the rest of this church. So God bless you, I celebrate you, and congratulations to you.
I'm asking Bishop to stand here with me because I would like to invite the family of Bishop Long to receive this award that we have put together in remembrance of the work that Bishop Long did for Beulah Heights and for the community at large. This plaque, I don't want to read the whole thing that are there, but those are the things that Bishop Long did for Beulah Heights, did for the ministry, and touched so many souls. Among some of these professors you see as a family, Bishop Long paid their tuition. I have been with him in Kenya. I've been with him in South Africa. I've been with him in Zimbabwe. I've been with him in Washington, D.C., and his heart is bigger than we will all ever understand. This is just a small token. When you look, you will remember what Bishop Long did for Beulah Heights and did for the community. We cannot say thank you enough. We can never say thank you enough for the work he did. Edward, I know you are a graduate of Beulah Heights, and we thank you for following the steps of your dad. I know Bishop Long, many people see him as a graduate of Morehouse, but he always says that when he took classes at Beulah Heights, that's where he learned how to preach. And I know you're going to be a preacher. So we thank you, we honor you, and I know I'm going to break the tradition and ask you just to say a word.
Thank you, sir. To the clergy, to the administration, to the student body, good morning. I'm not going to say a lot. I'm just going to say a few things. On behalf of my family, my brother, my sister, Elder Vanessa Long, my other brother, Jared, and on behalf of my father, he was a loving man, and this institution had his heart. Each of you had a walking today, as Dr. Karanja was saying, I had an opportunity to share this same pulpit last year during this time. And it was a joy for him to see me walk across the stage, but not only me, but everyone that was before me, with me, and those of you who are to come. Pop was a father. He had a father's heart, and he loved, again, this institution. So thank you all for receiving him. Thank you all for loving on him, and thank you all for running with the legacy of Bishop Long. Go forward doing all that God has called for you to do, because God said it, we believe it, and that settles it. Thank you.
Thank you. Now to the student, I know the time is moving, but let me give you a few words here that probably will help you down the road. Last Saturday, we talked a little bit about purpose, and I just told you in both in Atlanta and also in Columbus, that each of you have a purpose, and many of us, sometimes we lose that purpose and we get distracted. Today, I just want to complete that in the next 7 minutes by giving you ideas and reason why we lose our purpose. You ask yourself, what is my purpose in life? And why are you at Beulah Heights? When you get this paper and you go, that was not your purpose. Your purpose is bigger than the piece of paper you're going to get today. But I want to tell you just four things that I think we lose purpose. But I'm going only to talk about one. And the one I'm going to talk to you is about focus. We all lose focus. I sincerely believe we fail to reach our God-given purpose because we lose focus, especially in this age of technology, which has birthed Twitter, Facebook, WhatsApp, blogs, etc. In the social media arena, the life is changing very fast at a speed of light, maybe. By the time I finish this speech, it will be all over the world. It will be in Korea. It will be in Congo. It will be somewhere else. So things are changing. Let me talk to you. I want to continue discussing with you about focus. And I want to share you two stories or one story that involves two characters. In the Bible, we hear a story of Esau and Jacob. Bible does not say what really influenced these two boys. We only know Isaac, the father, had a liking for Esau. Maybe because he had his physical athletic abilities, while Rebekah, the mother, favored Jacob. Growth amplifies character. As they grew, Esau became a skilled hunter with strong abilities, and Jacob was a mild man dwelling in the tent. Esau depended on his physical abilities to survive. When Esau's mentality was that he's going to survive everything by using his physical abilities. He used the mentality that I can do because I'm strong. But I want to tell you today that the strength you have and what you have today is a currency to buy your future. So use it wisely, my dear student. Jacob was a mild man. The word mild is derived from Hebrew word tam. It carries an idea of a quiet, gentle, and upright person. That may sound quite opposite of what we know about Jacob and his characters. Meaning to take his we think of Jacob swindling his brother, lying to his father. Those are the characters we think about. So we think him about being a fraud, a manipulator, tricky, a mama's boy. However, the Bible considers him as an upright man. I want you to think about that carefully. And I'm going to bring you home on that in a minute. God changed his name later to Israel to represent his true character and heritage, meaning a prince who prevails. Upright did not mean he never made mistakes, he never sinned, or faced challenges. That is the same thing in your journey, student, dear student. You're going to meet challenges. You're going to meet enemies. But at the same time, God does not only see that. He sees beyond what you see. Because Jacob, despite of all those things that happened, he stayed on God's purpose. He depended on God. He was a mild man with a quiet, thoughtful, calculated, contemplative man. Every move, he thought carefully what he's going to do. He worked through his mind, developed ideas, and used his creative mind and wisdom to solve his problem. Further studies of Jacob reveals a man of great vision, imagination, and innovation. The main difference between Esau and Jacob's approach of life was apparent in that phrase, so the boys grew, and Esau was a skilled hunter, a man of the field. Jacob was a mild man dwelling in the tent. Esau, as a hunter, again, as I said, his production was based on physical abilities to accomplish his task. He employed his great strength, athletics. He could run after deer and do a lot of great things depending on his physical ability. Jacob, on the other side, he was a contemplative man, cultivator, operated from productive paradigm of using power and force of imagination. I want you to imagine as you move out there. Ministry is not about having so much resources, but it's about understanding how things happen. I want to use your purpose. Never lose that. Never lose what God has put in you. And a calculated planning in accomplishing his task. Well, Esau was running with his feet. Jacob was running using his mind. You're graduating today. So much has been put in you by these professors. Use it wisely. He used his imagination to produce more animals and grow and a good farmer rather than going out and running like his brother in the bushes. That was the difference. From his young age, Jacob knew one thing, and that is what I'm finishing with. What was his purpose? And his purpose was what? It was a blessing. Number one, as a young man, he bought his first blessing from his old brother with the food. He said, "You must bless me." The second blessing, he tricked his father, and he got his blessing. The third one, which was the strongest one, he wrestled with the God throughout the night, and he got his blessing. So when you know your blessing, you will see the moment, you will seize the opportunity. That's what happened to Jacob. He wrestled with God. He tricked his father. He tricked his brother with food. But his focus from the beginning was about blessing. What is your purpose today? At the end of the day, what Jacob did to his brother, to his father, his mother, uncle, and God, he overcame all that, and his name was changed to Israel. When you go out there, student, you need to know your purpose. And your purpose should never be distorted because of what is happening today and now, or what you have right now. Your goals should never be confused with the purpose that God put in you. And as I said earlier, you're going to meet all these roadblocks, and it's going to be difficult. But I want you to know that God has purpose for you, and he is going to make sure that you go through. We love you, and I appreciate you, and we congratulate you, and this is another time, and this is your day, and this is your season. You're going to have fun, but remember, never lose your purpose. Even if you're wrestling with God, you're going to wrestle with God and ask him to bless you, because that is what you want, or to give you a purpose. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and congratulations to the graduation class of 2017. Amen. Yes, give them another round of applause. Applause yourself. Look to somebody and applaud them, too. We are all proud of you and for what you've accomplished. We know that you've had to overcome obstacles along the way to complete this portion of your academic journey. Every year, the registrar, the academic dean, and faculty are responsible to identify a student to represent the student body as the class valedictorian. This is not an easy process, as many factors are considered, to include grade point average, the number of hours earned at Beulah Heights University, displays of integrity and godly character, to name a few. This year, two students qualified for this prestigious award. Both students have displayed outstanding academic achievements throughout their time with us. In order to choose, we had to look at the number of hours each student completed at Beulah Heights University compared to those transferred in from other colleges, as well as whether the student had completed all coursework at the time of selection. Through this process, we selected the valedictorian. However, our academic committee has agreed that we should also honor the second student as the salutatorian, and this year our honorees display BHU diversity at its best. Today our salutatorian will be presented with a medallion and a plaque. The recipient has not only excelled academically, but has also modeled servant leadership as a frequent campus volunteer and student worker. His name will be added to the list of other salutatorians, such as John F. Kennedy, John Wayne, Connie Francis, Carrie Underwood, John Legend, and former First Lady Michelle Obama. Our salutatorian is an international student from the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Welcome. I've been to Congo a few times. I enjoy it. The second largest country in Africa. Born of Jacques and Bijou Vidoso, Madi is the third born in a family of six children. He holds a high school diploma in biochemistry as well as an associate degree in biomedical sciences from the Protestant University of the Congo. Madi worked as a minister at Philadelphia Missionary Center in the Congo before being sent to America by his church for the purpose of studying. In the spring of 2014, Madi started with the Bachelor of Arts in Leadership Studies program at Beulah Heights University. Madi defines himself as a strongly people-oriented and family-centered man. He likes to read and views himself as a lifelong learner. Madi is already looking ahead to the PhD program following the completion of a master's degree. He has a bright future ahead of him. Please help me welcome our class of 2017 salutatorian, Madi Wayakiwa Vidoso. Valedictorian for the class of 2017 will also receive a medallion and a plaque. Today she'll be honored and listed among other well-known valedictorians such as Alicia Keys, Hillary Clinton, Paul Robeson, Coretta Scott King, and the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. Thelma Alston Burton. Is an ordained associate minister at New Shield of Faith Christian Ministries, serving under Pastor John S. Battle. She has served in ministry for over 25 years, receiving her foundational teachings under A.R. Bernard at Christian Cultural Center in Brooklyn, New York. Born in North Carolina, she lived most of her life in New York City, attending Pace University, majoring in business administration. Ms. Alston had an extensive career in the brokerage and investment banking business as a research publishing manager and banking analyst administrator before relocating to Fayetteville, Georgia. She's grateful that her 82-year-old mother, Celestine Alston, is still alive. Amen. Ms. Alston is a true paradigm of God's keeping power. In 1994, she experienced one of the greatest tragedies in her life, where she lost all three siblings back to back within the same year. Ms. Alston is a 23-year cancer survivor and stands strong. Amen. Stands strong despite sarcoidosis and Graves' disease. She's also a survivor of the 9/11 attack on the World Trade Center. She's married to her husband of 14 years, Fred Burton. She has one daughter, Tina Clasp, who currently lives in New York City with Ms. Alston's five grandchildren and five stepchildren. She is the founder of the Christ Over Cancer Foundation, formed in 2010 in honor of her sister who succumbed to brain and breast cancer. Ms. Alston was recently appointed to serve as the head executive of the board of directors for the domestic violence organization of Woman to Woman and Associates in Riverdale, Georgia. Following graduation, Ms. Alston plans to continue her studies towards her Master's of Divinity for a concentration in chaplain ministry as she oversees and pours into the Christ Over Cancer organization, which she is passionate to get off and running at full speed. Ms. Alston says that Beulah Heights University became a saving grace for her at her lowest point when her son passed away. And she will forever be grateful for her instruction at BHU, which has elevated her to another level in Christian education and helped deepen her relationship with God. Please help me welcome our class of 2017 valedictorian, Thelma Austin Burton.
To God be the glory, dominion, majesty, and power. Class of 2017, we have finished this assignment strong. Dr. Karanja, faculty and staff, distinguished guest speaker, friends and family, and to the esteemed class of 2017. Thank you for this honor and privilege to address this glorious assembly. I would like to also thank Dr. May Reggie, who's not here today, who has truly been a source of motivation and inspiration during this experience. I love her dearly. To my pastor, who recommended that I come to Beulah and who inspired me. And to my husband, I want to thank you for all the late nights that you have endured with me during this journey. I am filled today with words of encouragement to you that the question will be the answer, what next? We have been accurately disciplined in God's truth along our discipleship journey here at Beulah Heights University. We have been empowered with the tools to contribute to the fulfillment of God's will as our destiny is likened to that of Christ, to seek and save the lost and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ by teaching. We have presented our bodies as a living sacrifice, set apart for God's use, to be acceptable to Him. This is our reasonable service. We have been transformed by the renewing of our minds. We have been made ready to go out and test our education, the good, the acceptable, and the perfect will of God. We will be fruitful in our engagements, and we will never perish, for we lack nothing. We have been well taught on what it takes to be strong, resilient leaders. And we have learned to continue to follow the one, which is our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Today, May 6th, 2017, we begin an even greater journey as the new disciples of our time, charged to go forth. I encourage you today to put the soles of your feet to the ground and walk humbly with God. Do justly, love mercy, speak the truth, the word of God, bold and fiercely, empowered by the Holy Spirit, that you have been changed, that you will give change, not just for someone, but also for the world. Continue to seek wisdom with consistency in your purpose to be like Jesus Christ. Inspired by the words of Marian Anderson, I encourage you to embrace your divine purpose, knowing that happiness lies in the joy of achievement and the thrill of your creative effort. Now, as the Holy Spirit navigates us into uncharted waters of life, knowing that God has our back, we must now give back. We must give in word and in deed to those in need, as the disciples did before us. Like the 12 disciples of Jesus in a circle, and like the 70 that he has sent out according to the Gospel of Luke, we have been thoroughly finished to do all good works. We have been inspired by the scriptures and demonstrated it profitable use of doctrine for reproof, for correction, and for instruction and for righteousness. If the 12 could change the world, what about the 128 of us? Just as Jesus and his disciples did. Jesus prayed for his disciples and he prayed for this class of 2017. He prayed that we would succeed in the goals that he has set before us. What next? You ask. What next? Where do we go from here? The answer, my esteemed classmates, wherever we go with God. To God be the glory, dominion, majesty, and power. Class of 2017, we have finished strong.
That's great. That's what you become when you come through Beulah Heights. Thank you. Thank you so much. On July 28th, 1918, in the afternoon, right at Burn Street, one couple, having come back from Azusa Street, revival that was going on in California, they invited a few friends to join them in their house. And in that afternoon, according to handwritten minutes, they prayed and they believed that God was guiding them or directing them to start an institution known as Beulah Heights Bible Institute. And they believed that God was telling them to train members and leaders to go and change the world. They believed that Jesus is coming back so soon that they were buying one-way ticket after training students for 3 months to go out in the world. Some of our students went to Central America, South America, some went to Africa, some went to Brazil, some went to India, and some of our students were killed in the field because of the gospel of Jesus Christ. These two couples with their friends, they gave everything that they owned. Where we are right now, at the corner of Burn Street, we have been there for 99 years. All those properties that you see there, almost most of them, they were donated by these couples. And next year we'll be celebrating 100 years of this ministry. That is not a small thing. And I wonder, when they see all these millions who have been touched by their ministry, when they are walking there with Paul and Peter and the rest of them, what are they saying? And I do believe that Peter and Paul is telling them, well done, my faithful servant. It is our season today. It is our time today. We have been there. There will never be an excuse to say, I never knew. Therefore, I'm asking you to commit yourself and one time, a longer time, if you go to your programs, there is an envelope there which we are asking you to commit yourself or to give now. It doesn't matter whether it is $1. To know that 100 years from now, there will be some other student who will be sitting in the same classes that you're sitting that will feel they were blessed by the people who gave everything that they could. That couple gave everything that they own. And I'm asking you all today, this is not for operation or anything. Most of our students, we saw students from Congo, we saw students from Kenya, we saw others. Many of them receive a scholarship from Beulah Heights. Our budget for a scholarship is so huge. I don't even want to say about it here today. Therefore, I'm asking you to be part of this ministry, to be part of that meeting that was there on July 28th, to say that we need to train leaders to change the world. May God bless you. May God speak to your heart. May God speak to your spirit as you commit yourself what you're going to do. God bless you. Thank you, worship team. Thank you so kindly. Thank you and bless you. You can know that I don't do offering. I did not pray for offering. I should have done that. But we thank God that he's going to bless even when we don't ask. Many times we have to think we have to do these things. I normally sit down and let people do it, but I did it today, but I didn't pray. But therefore, I'm a Presbyterian. Normally, sometimes we eat and then thank God later on. So those who are offended, I apologize. And now I have time to come. That time has come for me to introduce a person that I have a lot of respect. I have known our speaker for over 30 years since I came to the United States. But that was far on TV, and maybe sometimes in occasion when she's busy and I'm passing by and we just shake hands and move forward. But you know, God always knows the timing and the season. I don't have really, for the people who are from Georgia, I don't have to introduce Monica Kaufman Pearson. I really don't. She don't need any introduction. She comes to your house whether you like it or whether you invite her or not. She will show up. And the thing that I want to read, I'm going to read only one thing because you have all her program there. But before I read that part that I'm going to read, I was sharing with her when I came to the United States and I did English, and one of the things that we were doing was communication. And Dr. Edward, Dr. Keeler, you can remember Dr. Edward. And we did speech to inspire, speech to persuade, speech to do that. The speech to influence, in my speech, I remember very clearly that evening that the character of the people I talked about influencing my life and who influences many people was Ms. Monica Kaufman at that time and Peter Jennings. I never knew that one day she will come when I'm the president to be able to deliver our commencement. I wish I had recorded that. That would have been a gift to her. The special thing with our speaker is that she's always smiling. But she knows how to change when she's going to announce something. Whether it is a morning, whether it's something that is dangerous there, she changes. She always inspired me. And anybody came to Georgia at that time, they knew somebody who will always influence her. According to her bio, you can see here, she was the first African-American to be an anchor, especially in Atlanta area. And that is not a small thing. It's a big history to think about that. But the part I want to read for you, student, is this part which says, since retiring in 2012, she didn't go to Florida and just go out there and rest. She went to school. She stayed busy. She graduated with a master's degree, magna cum laude, from University of Georgia, Grady College of Journalism and Mass Communication 2014. Until recently, she wrote a column, Monica Matters, for quarterly magazine, Southern Season, and taught Atlanta Metropolitan State College. She's a much sought after MSc and MC and motivational speaker and a host of 3-hour weekly music and talk show on Sunday, KISS 104.1 FM and R&B station, as well as does close-up interview with WSBTV.com. Why am I emphasizing that? I'm emphasizing that because of you as a student, because we are here because of you. Every one of us, your family, your pastors, and everybody, we're here because of you. So this is not the end of what your game, but a beginning. There's a big calling for you. And therefore, I'm challenging you, don't park your car and throw the key. It's just a new beginning of your journey. And there is no one else that can inspire you more than our speaker who is about to come today, who have done everything for this city and this state and received so many awards. You can read them all here. And because I don't want to take much of our time, I want you all to join me, if you all can stand up for a moment, to welcome our speaker today, Ms. Monica Pierce.
It is so good to be here with you this afternoon. To the president, the faculty, my graduates, students, and guests, good day. And thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to speak to the graduating class of Beulah Heights University, where you are developing relevant Christian leaders for ministry and the marketplace. Now, the title of my text today is Peter the Rock for All Ages. Now, to be very honest with you, I was surprised by the invitation. Since I am a former journalist, married to the senior elder at Gospel Tabernacle Church, John Pearson, Gospel Tabernacle Church, Bishop Wiley Jackson, whose younger brother is sitting over there as a department chair, Reverend Dr. Rodney Jackson. Now, my husband, John, is a lifelong law enforcement executive, but he's always been involved in ministry. From teaching Sunday school at GT to, yes, lifting the offering to praying, and he's been known to take a few classes here at Beulah Heights University. He is much better suited for this than I am. After all, I am a cradle Catholic whose mother made sure after her divorce that I was raised in the Catholic Church, but every summer, Hattie made sure that I went to vacation Bible school at Antioch Baptist Church in Louisville, Kentucky. She was a convert to Catholicism. But you know, the more I thought about today, I thought about how we all are joined in our belief in Jesus Christ, no matter our denomination or non-denomination. Our foundation is built in faith on Jesus Christ. And you know, he used two men that I will call bricklayers to build the first floor of that early ministry. After his Damascus Road experience, Paul, the former prosecutor of the way, became the major vehicle for the Gentiles to come to Jesus, literally. But there was Peter first, who thought the teachings of Jesus were just for the Jews, but then changed his mind after he saw Gentiles receive the Holy Spirit, just as he had on Pentecost Sunday. He then went to the home of Cornelius the Gentile and proclaimed in Acts, quote, God does not show favoritism, and Gentiles did not have to follow Jewish law to follow Christ, and has had been the practice. But I'm starting to get ahead of myself, so let me stop. Let's get back to the original story. In order of what we can learn from this man, this apostle, who was born the name of Simon in Bethsaida. He lived in Capernaum. Both places are by the sea. So naturally, he would be a fisherman. But Jesus renamed Simon Peter, the rock, because Christ said Peter would be an integral part of establishing the church. Quote, upon this rock I will build my church. Matthew 16, 18, 19. Now those of us in ministry, anyone trying to bring others to Christ, and we are in ministry, can learn a lot from Peter, both good and bad. It was Peter's brother Andrew who learned of Jesus first through John the Baptist and told his brother about Jesus. A question to my graduates and to those of you in this room. How much of what you know and love about Jesus have you shared with others? How much did you learn from others about Jesus? And did you pass it on, or did you keep it to yourself? How much do you share? Now, you can do it in the way that you live, being an example of a Christ-centered life, doing what is always right, even when people aren't looking, living by the Ten Commandments. Sometimes at work, something as simple as a prayer or a bowed head before your meal, a birthday card with a faith message rather than a funny or off-color card. Even saying sincerely, God bless you, when somebody sneezes. You never know how that may bring someone out of the cold and into the warmth of the love of Jesus Christ. Andrew shared his good news about Jesus with his brother. How do you share the good news of Jesus? So when Jesus finally met Simon, who he called Peter, Peter had been fishing all night and caught absolutely nothing. He was ready to hang it up and go home and have dinner and see his wife. When Jesus took over his boat and began to preach. Have you noticed it seems like preachers and deacons and mothers of the church always have a way of coming by and calling when you have something to do or just don't want to be bothered? Then Christ tells Peter, go back into the water and lower the nets again. Now, Peter has just cleaned the nets. He's worked all night. He was a professional fisherman, and he knew what he'd just been through. He stated the facts to Jesus, and then what did he do? He obeyed. It netted him more than he ever thought it would. So much fish that he had to call for help. It's all there in Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. At the end, Jesus told him, do not be afraid. Henceforth, you will be catching men. Peter left everything immediately and followed Jesus. Now, all of you want to be catchers of men and women. You want to bring people to Christ. But sometimes things seem to just get in the way. You have your vision board. You feel you are called to make a difference in the lives of people. You work a job. You're active in your church. You read the Bible daily. You pray. You visit the sick. You fast. You feel you are a professional when it comes to leadership. But you can't seem to get the break you want, the break you need to be where you want to be. Well, I have to ask you, are you doing what you want to do? Or are you doing what God is calling you to do? Peter knew the difference, but do you? Could something as simple as not tithing, not giving an offering, be blocking your blessing? When you do what God is calling you to do, when you are obedient, ministry is easy. Again, when Peter obeyed and dropped his nets back into the water, he had more than he could handle. And the next point to notice is, he shared it. That is part of ministry. Are you sharing your wealth, your gifts, both financially, spiritually, physically, your overflow with those around you? Peter also teaches us another lesson. Be careful what you ask for, because when you get it, if you take your eyes off of it, you'll regret it. Matthew chapter 14. Peter and the other disciples are where they love to be, on a boat in the water, late at night. And all of a sudden, there is this apparition. Some say it's a ghost walking in the water, but it is Jesus. And he tells them, take heart, it is I, fear not. Well, Peter is feeling his oats, and he asks to join Jesus in the water. Now, don't ask to be like Jesus if you're not ready for the good and the bad. Remember, he suffered and was crucified. Getting back to the story, Jesus says simply to Peter, come. Now, Peter is walking on the water. His faith is strong. And then the winds hit. He starts sinking and says, Lord, save me. Jesus takes him by the hand and says, oh, man of little faith, why did you doubt? Is there sickness in your family? Is there death? There are financial problems. You're afraid, and your faith, the faith you professed in good times, slowly is fading, and you are sinking into a sea of depression. Doesn't matter what you've learned here. It's what life is doing to you out there. I ask you, where is your faith? I've survived two cancers. Breast cancer 20 years ago. ...60% of my liver was removed 2 years ago because of cancer. And my faith got me through it. I called upon my elder, my husband, even though he said, you're gonna be fine. I said, the Bible says, anoint me with oil, get in here. I prayed, I fasted, I believed without a doubt that it was not my time. And when my own mother at 92 could say to her only child, baby, none of us came to stay, I truly relaxed and said, thy way, O Lord, not mine. I had some great doctors, ladies and gentlemen, but you know they call it the practice of medicine. But only God can cure. I had to pull upon that faith last year when my mother, within a 3-week period, decided it was time to go home when she was diagnosed with cancer, uterine and bladder cancer. She was 93. As my mother lay dying, 2 days before my birthday, I sang to her, it is well with my soul. And for the first time in 3 weeks, she sat up, her eyes opened up, she smiled, and even though she couldn't speak, I knew it was well with her soul. She was at peace, and she had no doubt that she was going to be in the arms of Jesus. Peter's of Beulah Heights University, men and women, why do you doubt in unsure times, and where is your faith? There is so much more to learn from Peter that is relevant to today for Christian leaders, but the biggest lesson he learned was about pride coming before the fall and then overcoming despair to turn it into victory. On the night Christ was crucified, Peter and the other apostles couldn't even stay awake to pray with Jesus as he waited to be betrayed. Okay, how often do we say to God, my needs are more important than yours right now. My needs are more important than the church. My needs are more important to the community. I ain't got time for that. So I'll take care of me first, and I'll get to you later. That fateful night, Peter promised Jesus he would always be with him, would never forsake him. Jesus told Peter he would deny him 3 times before the cock crowed, and Peter said, no way. Well, you know what happened. Peter did. And when the cock crowed, Peter melted in tears. He failed when he was needed the most, but it was a growth moment for him too. Where Judas killed himself for the betrayal of Christ, Peter found forgiveness from Jesus himself. After his resurrection, Jesus told the women at the tomb specifically to tell Peter to meet him in Jerusalem. Mark 16:7. But it is in John, the 21st chapter, Jesus asked Peter a question three times and then gives him his orders. He asked Peter three times. Now remember, this mirrors the three denials of Peter. He asked Peter three times, "Do you love me?" And each time Peter says, "Yes." And Jesus follows that first yes with, "Feed my lambs." He's telling them what to do. The second time, "Tend my sheep." And the third time, "Feed my sheep." And then he turns to him and says, "Follow me." Peter was completely restored. There is a lesson in here for you that is relevant for today. No matter what you've done, no matter how unforgivable other people may think it is, no matter how you feel about it, please remember, Jesus forgives. But my students, why can't you forgive yourself? Why can't you forgive yourself? I've come to the conclusion that it's a God complex. We have a God complex. We forget we are just human. If God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit who lives within us can forgive us, there is no way we need to be looking at things that happened in the past. We must remember 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. If we are faithless, he will remain faithful, for he cannot disown himself. We are made in his image and likeness, ladies and gentlemen. We are his children. His love is unconditional love. And because of that unconditional love, Peter moved from fisherman to fisher of men. He was unschooled and rough around the edges until he was put into a tumbler of life, tumbled around until his edges were made smooth, polished like a stone, and then he was able to heal the sick in the name of Jesus. First, right after Pentecost, the man who was lame from birth, and then Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years until Peter said in Acts 9:34, "Jesus Christ heals you. Rise up and make your bed." And then he turned around and raised from the dead Dorcas, also known as Tabitha. He no longer doubted the power of Jesus Christ. So he could walk on water, he could make the ill well, and he could raise the dead. He no longer doubted. So I'm going to end my remarks on Peter, the rock, by looking at a day we will celebrate on June 4th. That is the day of Pentecost. That's when Peter truly came into his own. Acts chapter 2 places us in the time and space the Holy Spirit showed up and showed out. Tongues of fire over the heads of all the apostles. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and started speaking in different tongues. And foreigners who were outside the room, everyone who heard them in Jerusalem, could understand them. Quote, "Telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." Peter spoke so eloquently that day in Jerusalem, people asked him, "What shall we do?" In Acts chapter 2, verse 38, Pete said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." And they did. 3,000 of them accepted Christ that day as their Lord and Savior. Now, Beulah Heights University graduates, as you pick up your degrees today in religious studies, biblical education, leadership, national, nonprofit organization, whatever you're getting it in, please remember, you are a link to the past. You are part of a lineage reaching all the way back to Peter the Rock, who helped to establish the church based on the foundation of Jesus Christ. You are in direct line with Peter. The failures and the success of Peter, the failures and the successes he had, helped him to develop into what you want to be. A relevant Christian leader for ministry and in the marketplace. Now go and build upon it in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Hallelujah. At this time, we will recognize the graduating class of 2017. Will the candidates of the Associate of Arts Leadership Studies please stand and come forward? Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Chair of the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Associate of Arts in Leadership Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and Board of Trustees at Beulah Heights University. Sonia China Benjamin. Franchon L. Davis Harris. Izora Dennis. Kimberly Marie Hawkins. Willie Marcelin. Martin A. Ndungu. Kathy Jean Paris. Korshiva Taylor Dickerson. Mary Butler Wiley. Divine Zumba. Mm-hmm.
Professor Walter Turner, Associate Chair for Undergraduate Religious Studies, will present the candidates.
President, as Associate Chair of the Department of Religious Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree of Associate of Arts in Religious Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the Faculty and Board of Trustees of Beulah Heights University. Tommy Allison. Clark. Maria Cecilia Costa. Jim Doherty. Andrea Gabrielle Fisher. John Henry Ford Jr. Roosevelt Glover. Marcus Grover. Stephanie Lynn Higgins Harris. James Anthony Jackson III. Linda S. Owensby. Albert Parker. Joe Otis Porter. Ciara Gwinnett Sims. Frederick Leon Small. Paul Robeson Stanley. Jeremiah Williams Jr.
Come forward, please. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Bachelor of Arts in Leadership Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and board of trustees at Beulah Heights University. Mickey Davis Asbury. Marlena Jean Brooks. Shirley B. Harris. Andre Demetri Jackson. John Luther Jennings. Sheila Willis Jones. Brandon Keith Lacey. Marcia Charmaine Moore. Festus Karanja Nuguru. Joyce Thomas Orr. Midi Wayika Belosa.
Will the candidates of the Bachelor of Arts Religious Studies please stand and come forward? Professor Walter Turner, Associate Chair of the Undergraduate Religious Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Associate Chair of the Department of Religious Studies, I'm honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Bachelor of Arts in Religious Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the Faculty and Board of Trustees of Beulah Heights University. Martha A. Miller Jackson. Patricia Ann Mosey. Romanzia Sherrod Saunders. Antoine Renard Wesley. Marianne Wilkerson. Jared Marcellus Williams. Thelma Austin Burton. Rodero Lacante Carter. Edward Clark Jr. Gerald Churchill Cross II. Isaiah Gregoric. Michael Stephen Hammett. And his lovely bride, Sharon Anita Hammett. Alvin Mantian Koa.
Will the candidates of the Bachelor of Business Administration please stand and come forward, please. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Bachelor of Business Administration. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and Board of Trustees at Beulah Heights University. Kevin Kabunga. Junior Mobutu. Charles Masuro Bungwa. Stephanie Lasamba Makuna.
Will the candidates for certificate for chaplaincy please stand and come forward? Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree of a certificate for chaplaincy. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and board of trustees at Beulah Heights University.
I'm going to ask for us to respect the other graduate, please. If you receive your diploma, please go back to where you're seated, then so that we also can respect the others who are receiving. I understand the joy, but let's follow order so that we can be orderly people. I'm asking those students who are within there taking pictures, this is not the time. Where's Professor Shirandi? You need to let this student come now and see. We cannot have two events going on at the same time.
Ann Dennison. Kalia Gordon.
Candidates of the Master of Arts Leadership Studies, please stand and come forward. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree of Master of Arts in Leadership Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and board of trustees at Beulah Heights University. Cedric Lee Spears. Sonia Rochelle Johnson. Audrey Thomas. Teresa Monique Thompson. Anna Claudia Pajero Campos. Rufus Clemens Jr. Bernita Roseanne Crossland. Danielle Nudibur Eguil. Carol A. Davis. Melanie Lori Gober. Armistice Richardson.
Will the candidates of the Master of Arts Religious Studies please stand? Come forward. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Master of Arts in Religious Studies. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and Board of Trustees at Beulah Heights University. Sandra Faye Delaney. Neva Jo Franklin. Timothy Oliver Harris. Camille Maurice Holmes. Bridgman E. Landers. Robert Lee Miller III. Veronica C. Patrick. Pamela Charlotte Jordan Price. Darlene Howard Robinson. Willa Deidred Spencer Cooper. Tyrone Thomas. Marion Sylvia Wells.
Stand and come forward, please. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Chairman of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Master of Business Administration. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and board of trustees at Beulah Heights University. Veronica Allen. Soon Ming Beck. Chong Wong Lim. Nashana Amina Grant. Robert Clay Robinson. Sale Corinthians Knox the Fourth.
We also have a candidate for a Master of Business of Administration from the Congo cohort. We had three that graduate, one that was able to make the journey, and we're gonna ask him to come at this time. And all the way from Congo, we have a cohort there, and we've graduated many students from that cohort.
Mr. President, as Chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree of Master of Business Administration. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and board of trustees at Beulah Heights University. Robert Ebono. Thank you.
Will the candidates of the Master of Divinity please stand and come forward, please? Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree of Master of Divinity. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and Board of Trustees at Beulah Heights University. Juanita Amor. Jacqueline Elizabeth Boyer. Mary E. Glasper. Jung Sik Ng. Tisha N. McClain. Kimberly Don McMullen. Patience Issa Uguga Bunyubi. Dweba Nikki Webb.
Candidates of the Doctor of Ministry, please stand and come forward, please. Dr. Rodney Jackson, Department Chair of Religious Studies and Business and Leadership Studies, will present the candidates.
Mr. President, as Chair for the Department of Religious Studies, Business and Leadership Studies, I am honored to present these graduates to be awarded the degree Doctor of Ministry. I do affirm that they have completed the course of study as prescribed by the faculty and Board of Trustees at Beulah Heights University. Antoine Darrell Barlow. Kiwa Cho. Aaron Kunja Foster. David Bo-myung Kim. James Edward Harris. Bobby Ray Young. Jay Wong Saw. Young Ha Na. Chong Po Kim. Anthony Bertrand Hughie. Diana Hawkins.
Each year, the Association for Biblical Higher Education identifies the top 7% of the graduating class to receive the Delta Epsilon Chi Award. This year, we have 5 students from the graduating class of 2017. These students will also be inducted into the Beta Eta Beta Kappa Honor Society of Beulah Heights University for exhibiting outstanding character and high scholastic achievement. The certificate they receive will read, "The Association for Biblical Higher Education Honor Society proudly announces the awarding of scholastic membership to the students of Beulah Heights University in recognition of leadership ability, Christian character, and intellectual achievement, May 6, 2017. The honorees, as I read your name, please come forward. Thelma Alston Burton, Madi Wayika Vidoso, Joyce Thomas Orr, Tae Oak Kim, and Chong Kyung Cho. Once again, give yourself a big applause.
Congratulations. May all the graduates please stand. Congratulations. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask those who received doctor ministry, would you sit for a moment? It has been confirmed and affirmed that you have satisfactorily fulfilled the conditions and requirements prescribed for admission to various degrees as set in the university catalog. I have been approved by faculty and by the Board of Trustees. Therefore, by virtue of the authority vested on me, I have presented to each candidate a certificate of admissions to appropriate degree, and in doing so, shall admit them to the rank, privileges, and responsibilities of those degrees. You may officially turn the tassel to your left. Congratulations. Congratulations. worship.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, may those who receive Doctor of Ministry please stand. And join them. That's okay. You remain standing. The other ones remain standing. I have read, it is the same writing that you have received and you have been confirmed by the Board of Trustees. You may now turn your tassel to the left side. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to present to you those that have finished their Doctor of Ministry, the new doctors of the ministry. Honor your name and everything that you have in that. Congratulations. That is the largest doctorate degree candidate that we have awarded so far. And I'm so proud of you, knowing that you have become part of the 5% of the population in the United States. Congratulations. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want to present to you the class of 2017. Congratulations, and God be with you as you move forward. You may be seated. You may be seated. We are finishing now, and we'll be praying for you and blessing you. But I'll be not be doing a service to you if I don't tell you outside there is the table for admissions. We do have degrees in Associate of Arts degrees, Bachelor's of Arts degree. But there's one that I want to take you to talk to you and highlight to you that is going to start beginning this fall. If you come to Beulah Heights and finish your BBA degree in 4 years, if you finish in 4 years with 3.0, you will receive MBA free of tuition. So if you want, you can join that. If you finish with 4 years with a 3.0, your degree for MBA will be tuition free. It doesn't get better than that. The other one, and you all need to go out there and check on that. The other that I want to let you know is that we are starting also another degree this fall, which will have less hours than the MDiv that you're going to do. And that MDiv that you're going to, if you complete that MDiv, you will receive certification in the state of Georgia without sitting for the certification exam, to be able to do pastoral counseling. I do understand if you do that, you'll be able to earn from $60,000 to $100,000. So a master's degree in divinity that is going to start this fall will also give you a certificate in that area. More details are out there. This is just on an infomercial. So when you leave, just talk to the people in the admissions office and admissions table, and they'll let you know. Did I miss anything else, Dr. Wilson? Thank you so kindly. I would not do all the things that happened today without the faculty, without the staff, without all these people who are doing the little things that I'm not seeing. I'm seeing because I'm holding the microphone. But the work that has been done for us to be here, I can only say thank you. Can we all just just clap your hands together and just say thank you for the great work that you all did. Thank you. Thank you, my son, my great grandson, my grandson. He is here with me. I know you are hungry, and my granddaughter, so thank you so much. The joy of my life. My wife is not with me. She is in Kenya. As I told you that my father-in-law had stroke, so she had to go to Kenya. So you all need to continue praying for us. Also, I want to say thank you to the people of New Birth for the work that you all have done the cameras, the ushers, the cleaning, and all those things, we thank you and honor you. We have no words to say thank you. Now I'm going to ask our worship team to come again and sing our song, and after that, it'll be our board member, Pastor Harris, Dr. Harris, to come and bless you all. Thank you, and God be with you as you go from here.
Were the place that I could go, show the path that I should go, the knowledge that you gave to me, producing me integrity.
Final blessing is upon us. Moses gave this blessing to the children of Israel as they were traveling from bondage into freedom. The struggling small nation became a large nation that represented a great and a powerful God. Let us receive the word of God and the blessings of God over us as we depart from this place. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. And the Lord be gracious unto you. In your coming and in your going, in your rising and in your setting, today and forevermore, may you be blessed in the field. May you be blessed in the city. May your storehouse be blessed. May the fruit of your womb be blessed. May all that you touch resound to the glory of God. The name of the Father, the name of the Son, the name of the Holy Ghost, we pray in Jesus' name. Let us all say together, amen. The Lord bless you.